You're watching Twit Live from Le Web in Paris, 2011. I'm Leo Laporte.
I'm Sarah Lane.
And our next guest is a legend, and really thrilled to have Jean-Marie Hulot on. Good to have you. Jean-Marie, talk right in that microphone there. CTO at Next. Yeah. Went over to Apple.
Yeah.
I have to ask you before we talk about Photopedia, because, and by the way, I think Photopedia is a gift to the internet. I really thank you for it.
Thank you very much.
It's very exciting. It is said that you told Steve Jobs you have to do a phone. Is that true?
Absolutely.
When was that?
It was in 2001.
And why was that?
You know, I was in a... I was at Next from the beginning to the end, and I became a very good friend of Steve. But I left Next maybe 3 months before the end because I'm a consumer-oriented person, and Next was getting to do more on software for businesses, which is not really my cup of tea, I must say. And Steve, at the same time, was mostly, to Pixar, because it was not his cup of tea either.
He wasn't interested either. Yeah.
So, at that time, I said, Steve, okay, I like you very much, but now it's time for me to move to something else. So I went back to Europe, but I stay very much connected with Steve. And, he liked to have a few people like that around the world that he was trusting. And he was coming quite often to Paris. It's a place that he was liking. So once he came to Paris, it was in 2001, and we were walking, because with Steve, it's always the most important thing happened during a walk. Mm-hmm. And he was asking me what I was seeing for the future, and I told him, Steve, you will have no choice. You will have to do a phone.
Really?
And basically, he told me bullshit.
Yeah, he said, you're wrong. But he was famous for that, right? And then later he probably came back to you and said, Mark, we should do a phone, Jean-Marie.
No. But, so that came later. But no, he told me, but why don't you come back and think about it?
Okay, good. Good.
And so we, I came back but not physically. I didn't move to the United States because I wanted to stay in Europe for a family reason. And I became CTO of the Apple application division. So that was my worldwide role. And we had a team in Paris, and we were investigating some phone stuff. And beyond that, I don't want to tell anything.
Story is true.
Okay, there you go. Well, thank you. Just thank you, by the way. You were right.
We really like our phones, so thank you very much.
And you were right, because really, this is where computing is happening now. Mm-hmm. So Photopedia is a website, but it's also an iPad app. It's also on Flipboard. It's also... So portable is important. Mobile is important.
Yeah. And, if we are a website, on the website, we are doing, in a way, our contents factory. Mm-hmm. But this was not a consumer story. So when the iPad came, I said, since we are in the pictures, this is our computer story.
Right.
And we moved extremely fast to try our first application on the iPad, which was heritage like 14 months ago. Mm-hmm. And it has been an instant success. And the key is that, and it has nothing to do with my relationship with people at Apple, but they love it. And immediately after 2 weeks, it was the app of the week all over the world.
Yeah.
Well, it's the sort of app that works so well on an iPad because it's so visual. I know your newest app is the Japan.
Japan, yeah.
It's great. Let
me pull up Japan. I've got Mallorca here.
Yeah, Japan. As you have seen, we didn't do. We have lots of contents, and we decided not to go for one application with to put all of our contents like many are doing, because if you really want. What we all want with this application is to get traction, to get lots of downloads. Mm-hmm. And my theory was that, if you really want to get an exponential, it's really hard to achieve with one application, because everybody will tell you that basically you get a bell curve, and after that it gets down. So what we decided is when we reach, when the bell curve is starting to go down, we launch another application, which is pulling the previous ones. And
you keep it going up and up and up.
And if you look at what happened with Japan, in 1 year we did 5 million downloads with our other application. Mm. And Japan, which was launched 3 weeks ago, mm-hmm. we did 1 million.
In the first week, 3 weeks.
In 3 weeks.
Yeah, amazing. Amazing. So the idea of this is a Wikipedia for photographs. And photographers are expected to upload their images to this, yes?
Yeah, that's part of the story. We are sourcing pictures from crowdsourcing, which is exactly what you explained.
And you choose, by the way, you choose the license. You can choose a Creative Commons license.
You
can decide how it's...
You choose the license you want.
Yeah.
And the only thing, it's, if it is your pictures, you choose the license you want. If you are taking some picture from a Flickr or other place on the internet, it has to be... some Creative Commons flavors, so that we can reuse it.
And then you look it up and you apply the appropriate license for it.
And we never use, pictures in a place where we should not use them. Like if they have non-commercial, okay, we don't use these pictures in a commercial environment.
Is this commercial? Are you monetizing it?
Oh yeah. For instance, the Japan application, it has been sponsored by Narita Airport. You know, after the catastrophe in Fukushima, they were looking for a solution to. Talk to all the world, to get people back to Japan, and with a typical Japanese message, very respectful and everything. And it
seems has a nice sort of splash page when you first launch it.
Absolutely,
welcome to Japan.
It's not ugly. It doesn't.
It all works. Yeah. It's the same mood. No, it's beautiful.
But the key is that we have a totally global reach. I mean, so we are the one who through the mobile can talk to all the world. And for instance. At this point, 40% of our audience is coming from Asia, and 30 from America, and 30 from Europe, and which was totally different 1 year ago. Because what happened during the year where since we started doing mobile application, China exploded, and now and last week, China became our country number one.
No kidding.
Yeah. Wow.
To what do you attribute that?
I mean, first. The Chinese, they are really eager to get these devices, and there is this new, rich people who are, for them, it's typically, it's a brand, Apple is a big brand, so they get it, and they move to it.
Right.
But so that's one factor. The other factor is that these people, from what I can understand, in a way, they jumped over the web.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Immediately landed in the mobile space.
Yeah.
And this is going like crazy.
I think that's going to be the case in many areas, right?
Yeah. But and in our special case, the fact that what we have is extremely visual, it helps. Even before we were localized in China, we got lots of success and attraction in China.
Because there's no language barrier. Pictures.
So now we have everything, and in Chinese, Japanese, and Korean, because country by country, we understand how to crack the country. Mm-hmm. And after that, when one of our application is entering a country, for instance, South Korea, we went there because we did an application in North Korea. It got instant success in South Korea.
Wait a minute, you did an application in North Korea?
No, we have a photographer.
In North Korea?
A professional photographer who did some work in North Korea, and we got all of his content. We did this application.
Wow.
And instant success in South Korea.
Because they wanted to know what was going on up there.
Yeah, which is normal. But immediately, it drove lots of download of all our other applications, Heritage and Burma all of this. And now we are very successful in South Korea. So
interesting.
Country after country, we see this movement happening. And it's really interesting to look at that real time.
The images are beautiful. Even on the website, they're beautifully displayed. I mean, it really is, for people who love photography, gorgeous. See, it's Photopedia with an F, F-O-T-O,
It's with an F.
Media.com.
So you're also, you are showcasing all of the web talks as well.
Okay, so that's, in a way, some new experiment. We have a platform which is extremely powerful, in a way. So we want to, I would say for the moment, not make experiment. It's not clear that we want to take this direction at a bigger scale. But covering a live event that was something that I wanted to do since a very long time.
Right.
So, we are using the same tools in the middle, and so we have, there are 7 photographers all around, some from the web, some our photographers, and we have one journalist working with us. And real time, we just absorb all these pictures, and thousands of pictures that we have absorbed, we digest, and putting the right metadata and everything.
So
and
there is some editorial going on at
there
your
is
end?
Some editorial going, real time. It's very shallow. In a way, what I believe personally, and that's why I took this direction, is that publishing, what works in the mobile world, it's exactly the opposite as what's working in the printed world. The old world, in a way, what they were doing is they were writing articles and illustrating with pictures.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Now we do the reverse. Our stories are made with pictures,
yeah,
and we illustrate with some
give
text.
It a little context.
Yes. Well, yeah, but humans are very visual, so yeah, that's a it's a very natural thing.
And after that, when you look, you know, it's young people and even less young, but in public transportation, when the network is working,
yeah,
you know, this is you see it in their movement, how they consume the data. Yeah. This has totally
reading,
changed.
They're going like that, yeah. Mm-hmm. Flipboard's an interesting thing. So you decided to be part of Flipboard.
Yeah. So it's you know, we have lots of content. In a way, we are a media company, and we can distribute our content through you know, our own real estate, like you know, our mobile application.
Right.
But now we want to expand, and we want to you know, give our, I mean, push our contents to some other partners, and Flipboard is the first one of them, but mm-hmm, we want to go beyond. Mm. And so, but, you know, for each distribution channel, in a way, you have to find the form factor that is appropriate.
Right.
So for us, we are very successful with our application, that's
right,
perfect.
Right.
For Flipboard, it's different. What they needed, and I discussed it with Mike, it's, you know, these short stories, and I said, okay, so this is what we will do. We will extract, you know, like 10 pictures on a given subject, mm-hmm, get, you know, some editorial, and we have various ways to get this editorial, depending on where it comes from. The pictures, is it from the community? Is it from, you know, professional photographers, which may have the story already, or organization, which usually have more, you know, text around it.
Right.
So we repackage all of that, and we can do extremely fast because we have to produce quite a lot. It's like for Flipboard, we do 5 stories a day.
Wow.
And
but you have the workflow down. You can do that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, we have 2 contents per person.
That's all?
Company. That's all.
Holy cow.
Are there other apps, either for the iPad or even Android platform, that you think, oh, I'd really like to be part of this, but you haven't quite figured out how to port Photopedia into yet?
Oh, where we want to push our contents?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are some other, I will not get into details. I'm discussing with many of these people, but it can be, you know, the mobile world they desperately need some visual contents. And, you know, think about all the mobile operators. And, you know, they need it, for instance, with what we have for the moment for that travel property. I mean, they come to us all the time. We don't go too fast. You know, say,
they'll come to you.
What I learned from all my years at Next and Apple is remain focused.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, if you are focused, you get successful. So first, I really want to own our space.
Yes.
And then I can move on to the different direction, extended distribution, and this kind of stuff.
So let me ask you a little bit about Steve. Of course, the world really mourned his passing. Have you read Walter Isaacson's book yet?
What do
you think?
It's very hard for me because I was extremely close to Steve, and at some point, you know, even when I was at Next, since I never asked for a green card, I had some other thing to think about. After 6 years, I had to come back during 1 year here to wait until I can get a visa again to go back to the United States. So during that year, when I was going to the United States, I was living at Steve's house.
Wow.
So, in a way, I was one of these person who was in, you know, the right bucket.
Yeah.
So sometimes I find, and so for me, I like him. He's a nice guy.
It was a different experience for you. He loved you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and so he was very charming, I'm sure, and
absolutely,
and warm.
I mean, sometimes he can be, I mean, Steve is Steve. And when he has something to tell you, he doesn't hesitate. But at the same time, since I was close to him, it doesn't hurt.
You didn't see the dark side.
Dark side, it's hard to say. Okay, maybe there was some dark side. I could see how it could be difficult, especially working in a company. Because, and in a way, it was not difficult directly for me, but it was, you know, he was going to every level, and he was looking at everything. And when he was seeing something that was not good, he was just, you are doing a very bad job.
Right.
And in a way, the guy was not necessarily responsible, but after that, he was devastated.
Right.
And, you know, Steve, he just left, but you still
going.
Have to deal with all these people afterwards.
Right.
So as Steve is a management challenge because he's creating lots of noise.
Trouble. Yeah. But a genius.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm sure you'll miss him. And,
absolutely.
We all will. But we have these wonderful platforms to thank him for and to thank you for, because there's a lot of Next still in the Macintosh and in the iPhone, too, I guess.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, that's the same lineage. It's when you were there from the very beginning, and you know, lots of people who are at Apple today were the original Next
right.
people. But basically, it's most of the people who are, you know, the top people at right. Apple. I mean, there are some exceptions. Some people, Jonathan Ive and some other, Eddie
right.
Q, who is a really nice guy.
Right.
And, you know, but, you know, they are the exception.
Right, right. So people have that vision in their head.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I often thought, in fact, the day I saw the iPad in January 2010, I guess it was, maybe, I said, this is what Steve, I think, always wanted to make. That was kind of the, that's the computer for the rest of us, really.
When Steve Wozniak had said that was the original vision. It just took however many years.
Technology didn't catch
up. For the technology to catch up with the imagination.
So from the very beginning, after that, the evolution, I mean, this technology, touch and all of that, it was at Apple since quite a long time.
Oh, really?
But Steve never knew, I mean, first, it was not his focus at that time. So,
right.
And you know, early on, it was the iPod time, and he didn't want to move out of the iPod. Even the iPod itself, you know, he didn't want to introduce video, all this kind of stuff that other had inside the iPod until he 100% owned, you know, the music space, including selling music and everything. So, when he got 70%. He started to say, okay, we can add some.
But that you just referred to it earlier. That was very key, is focus. He says saying no to 1,000 things is a big part of the job.
That's the most important thing. And that's a danger, especially in a company like Apple, because they have lots of very bright people. Very bright people have you know, lots of ideas. And, you know, before with Steve, you know, he was deciding we do this thing, and usually it was a handful and even less than two or three.
Right.
And after that, there was no questioning for
right.
anybody. After that, all the energies of everybody was just refocusing on that. So you get all the brains of all these people, you know, focusing on that. Now it will be much harder because nobody...
you need a king of France. You need the roi.
Nobody will be able to take this
right.
I fear that this can end in endless discussion as usual
right.
in all these big companies
right.
And in a way it's just energy that is wasted.
Right.
How long does it take for something like Japan, which is your latest Photopedia app, from conception to giving it to the App Store?
So this case was an interesting one because in a way, we never do something with that, you know, other people will ask us. Or usually, we want to do something,
mm-hmm.
and you know, after that, we are starting to market it, to distribute it, and everything. In this case, it was a bit special because it's you know, Akuodo, which is the number two ad agency in Japan. They came to us and they say, "We have a client, Narita Airport." Would like to, you know, deliver a message to all the world, blah, 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 blah. And they wanted to do it in 1 month. And so Akodo said, we looked at, you know, nobody can do that, but maybe you can do. You can do it. And I said, that's interesting. So I didn't know if we had enough content. So I said, okay, we will do it. And so in less than 6 weeks, in this case, this
wow.
was on the App Store and sold.
How many photos are in your database now?
At this point, we have over 1 million pictures.
Wow.
But we are not measuring us. The number is not that big.
It seems big.
It depends, because if you look at people like Flickr, all these people,
it's much larger.
You know, it's billions of photos.
Right.
And well, our job, in a way, is exactly the contrary. So we are able to screen with the community and you know, our different filters, maybe hundreds of millions of pictures. But we keep
right.
only very few.
Right.
And make a test by yourself. Try to find a picture on a Flickr or Google image. And so you do a query. Try to find one where the quality is good enough and which is relevant for your query. It will be at most one out of 100.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we found the way our curation tool and helped by the community. We have a community of curators. It's both photographers and curators. But we have everything in place to make sure that we keep only the very high quality pictures with the right metadata.
You're doing a good job, because when I go through the magazine, if you go to photopedia.com, there's a magazine, and every single subject, every image, beautiful, stunning, they grab you. So you're doing it. And you say an interesting thing. Metadata is important too, because you have to find these, right? You have to collate. You have to some way to know what this is.
You have to know what this is. And you know, for instance, when it comes from the community, I mean, if, you know, some people are posting pictures.
Flickr tags are pretty much useless.
Yeah, it's pretty much useless. But what happens, and what is very common for the inexperienced people who are coming to our community, they just come back from vacation, let's say, from Italy, and they have 100 right. pictures, and they put everything, you know, under Italy.
Right.
So immediately you get the rest of the community getting to them, okay. So, you know, this picture, it's interesting. It's a good picture, but, you know, does it deserve to be in Italy? We do not know. It's a fountain in some city. Which fountain, which city? If you can tell us what it is, and so this is the work of the community, okay, ultimately it will maybe become number one for this fountain, number one for this city, and maybe ultimately become number one for Italy.
But it takes, you have to get there. So you have, is it like Wikipedia that you have volunteer editors like Wikipedia?
Yeah.
That's the community.
Yeah, that's the community.
Yeah. Yeah.
So after that, it's a pyramid. That is, we have, you know, the community and so, in a way, lots of contributors and, you know, less real curators who are really, so it's like, you know, Wikipedia today, it's people who are really doing the core work.
It's a small number.
Small number, 500 in the beginning, 1,500 at this point or something like that. And after that, at the very top, we keep in our staff a few people who are, you know, screening, but at the top of the pyramid. And we have two or three people. We have three people all together on contents, but you know, they have various tasks, so they don't even spend all their time. So this is already filtered. That's the key.
Right. Well, for example, you've got a nice picture here. I'm again looking at the Japan app. The photographer who took it is credited. We have a nice excerpt that is pulled directly from Wikipedia and says
In this case, it's Wikipedia. Yeah. And one thing that is really nice with Wikipedia is that all our tagging system is based on Wikipedia, and which means that when you say Italy, in a way, it's an Italy Wikipedia article. What is critical for that is that it is giving us automated translation.
So you're in every language that Wikipedia
is. So after that, we have it. We use all the cross-reference inside Wikipedia to make sure that it's Italy, you know, in Japanese, in Chinese, and blah, blah, blah. So when we localize our application, there is a first step, which is, you know, and basically it's 80 to 90% of what we do in terms of localization, which is totally automated.
That's great.
And after that, we have, it's always the same. To scale, you have to find a solution so that what you have to do manually or by paying people is reduced to the minimum.
Small as possible. Yeah. So great to meet you, Jean-Marie. Thank you so much for joining us. I love Photopedia.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for giving us something to talk about regularly on our iPad shows.
Gorgeous images and a brilliant idea, and I think a real contribution to all of us. So thank you so much for visiting
us. And
thank you very much
for your stories about Steve Jobs, too. Well, sounds like he's a pretty great guy.
Yeah, and I mean, we worked like 15 to even more than 15 years together. So.
Wow, that's amazing. Jean-Marie Hulot, thank you so much
for joining us. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. You're watching Le Web live from Paris 2011.